Hey guys, Fontes here, and today I will be talking about my trip to Kew Gardens. So when I arrived at college, I had to be there like literally before 8:30, early in the morning. Yes, I had to wake up so early. It gave me a bit of cold when I went there, so yeah, it was a bit chilly in the morning, but quite awkward and quiet because we were all waiting literally everywhere in college, and so we had to find a spot to meet with other people and meet it, and that was in the canteen. And so when it was the time to gather around at the reception, we all headed straight to the reception, registered our name, and then went on to the coach, registered again, and followed the principle of that, and yes, so after that, we headed straight away from college straight to Kew Gardens, and it was just 1.5 hours. And it didn't take that long, but time flew very fast when I was riding. I didn't want to take videos because it's awkward and it's very quiet. And of course, everyone was talking at the time. And of course, I got really tired, so I didn't want to do that just yet. So yeah, that was pretty much a boring travel. Of course, travels aren't that fun, but it will be at the end of it. So yeah, once I got there, within 1.5 hours, I noticed that I was in the western region of London, and that's where Kew Gardens was. And that was when I was able to start my journey in Kew Gardens, my adventure rather, in Kew Gardens. So when we arrived, we got off and walked straight to the gate, and the gate was Victoria Gate. And that was the first attraction of Kew Gardens. So the Victoria Gate is the main entrance of the Kew Gardens, and that's often the first attraction that everybody goes to when they go to Kew Gardens. So that Victoria Gate is also facilitated with a cafe and a store. So I decided to just walk around in the souvenir store than the cafe, because I didn't want to disturb anyone else in the Victoria Gate, as it would look really awkward. So once I'd spent my time walking around, I enjoyed a lot of things, seeing candied and sometimes chocolate, and as well as the books and sometimes the antiques, which is the pottery stuff and the other glass related items. And they're all pretty expensive, you know, like 20 to 40 pounds, depending on your budget to spending in a store. So after the Victoria Gate, I went outside the Victoria Gate and I saw the Victoria Gate Tower. Now that tower is a very, very strange looking tower, because I thought it was a church bell tower, but then at the same time I thought it was a headquarter tower. Yeah, two different things, but very similar characteristics of those kind of towers. So yeah, I actually assumed that they were that, and I kind of felt a little embarrassed when I saw that, but yeah. And it looks like it has a bell on the top of it, otherwise it may just be where people would stand in there and check out the view of Kew Gardens at the Victoria Gate. So after the Victoria Gate, I then saw the, what looks to be a very small sort of temple or house, White House rather. Not the White House that you see in the United States, but this sort of White House. So I saw, it looks like where you would remember someone who worked at Kew Gardens, because they had this metal bronze plate stuck onto the wall, and there were names on them. And there were dates of whether they died or whether they finished working at Kew Gardens. That's what I did see on the board. So it looks like a memorial sort of place for someone who were close to the employees and staff who worked at Kew Gardens a long time ago. So That is my talk on the
The next
Victorian.
attraction was the Palm House. So after walking around that place in the Victoria Gate, I then walked past this really tall tree, which looks to be one of the trees that you would use on Christmas, but it's not a Christmas tree, but it looks like one of those. However, it looks like one, in my opinion. So aside of that, I then walked past this lake. I don't even know the name of the lake, but it's the main lake that you would see in front of the Palm House, which is then in front of the another house. But that's a different sort of house, and I don't even know the name of that either. So as I went to the Palm House, I didn't go to the main entrance, which was at the front where the big tall double doors were. I went to the side where most people would probably have went to, and I tried to open it because it was so cold outside. I had to push with the whole body then with my pair of arms, and because the door was so heavy, I had to push with all of my might. Yes, although I didn't have very good traction effort when I was walking, but there you go. So as I went in, I suddenly felt much better because all of the blood that was circulating on my hands were back to normal, in normal condition, and I was able to articulate them properly than I was outside the farmhouse. So as I went in, I saw a series of green plants ranging from weed size to tall tropical tree size. Yes, they're all different and unique. They all have different characteristics and different builds to them that are very different to each other. Some of them that I know, some of them that I don't know. So there is one tree that is very familiar if you have been to the Philippines, and that's one of the palm trees, but they're not called the palm trees. They're often called banana trees because they grow banana in the Philippines. So that's probably what they are called, but I don't know. So those are the trees that I saw. And then I saw some other plants that you would normally find in your backyard, especially ones in your school. And sometimes ones that are in front of your house, like a bush, a normal sort of bush, and some weed-side grass and weed-side plants. So those are the plants that I was able to see in the farmhouse. So after walking around on the first floor, I then went onto the staircase to take some more pictures on a different level. I know that I got dizzy when I went around the spiral staircase, when I know I don't like going round and round things, but I had to, just for the sake of going onto the conservatory level of the farmhouse. So when I went onto the conservatory level, I saw that there's a different view of this farmhouse. And I was able to see all of the plants in a different level. I was looking down at them. And as I looked down at them, I saw that they all looked much prettier and more beautiful than they were than I looked at them on the floor. So I decided to take pictures. Obviously, that was my main initial task whilst I was around the Kew Garden. And it was videos, so yeah, two things. Yes, very busy at the time, but there was a lot of light coming through, although it wasn't sunny when I went in there. It was mainly cloudy, but the whiteness of the cloud shone through the glass on the farmhouse roof, and I kind of liked the lighting because it was so pale and white, and I was able to capture a very good picture with good white balance on my DSLR, and it turned out pretty well, although I won't be using that as my thumbnail because that's not what Kew Gardens is based on. But the main attraction was the farmhouse because there are lots of plants that you would find in the farmhouse than you would find outside at this time of the year, whereas in summer you would find more plants. So I have had a very good time walking around the conservatory level, and I have taken pictures of the roof, the canal roof, or what looks to be like the hallway roof, where you would find different plants touching the roof. Pretty darn good. And that was the farmhouse. So as I finished taking pictures of the inside, I decided to go outside, where I had to take the whole building as a picture. So When taking the picture, I realized that I have to take it at a slight angle and not right on front because I want to be able to use it with the style of Gucci designer, the Swiss designer, Swiss graphic designer. So, yeah, I had to angle it that way in order for me to achieve a very good shot. And that's very interesting. But then I had to go at the front. The front was very stressing because I had to wait for people to evacuate from the building or not obstruct my shot. And I got a very good shot on that one. So that wasn't too bad either. So that's my talk on the Palm House. So that was the Palm House. I then left the Palm House and I went to a sort of field where people were working in. They were all planting plants, basically. Flowers, maybe. I don't know what plants they were planting, although they had a wagon full of them. Yes, and they were going around and planting the plants. And then I saw this open space that was right in front of the palm house on the other side. That was the lion's walkway or something, but that's the walkway. I don't even know the name, but that's the walkway. And in front of it, I saw a series of tall trees on either side, so it looked like a very giant path. And in front of the path, there was this bench. This bench is a memorial bench of a couple, I guess. I didn't read the label of it, but I'm assuming it is. In many places in Kew Gardens, you would find memorial benches. So this is the first one that I saw in Kew Gardens. So this memorial bench was very couple designated because it may have been like many years that that couple had been to Kew Gardens and had been walking around that space in Kew Gardens. But before that one, I then saw this really strange tree, which may look like the Whomping Willow, but it isn't because the Whomping Willow would have the curly, swirly texture on its stem and on its branches, and then it would have very strange characteristics at the end of its branches, and you would know what that is, right? But that wasn't very close enough to the Whomping Willow because the Whomping Willow is very different to other trees that I see all the time. Because that one is magical, as Harry Potter said, or maybe had not said. But that's the Whomping Willow, but this one is not, so. However, this one has sort of a door at the bottom of the stem. That's where squirrels would go into. Yes, I did say squirrels. Squirrels will go under that door and go up into the tree and store all of their acorns and nuts, I guess, for winter hibernation. And I think they may have done that already last year, so it was winter still, but it is spring. Well, coming to spring at this time of the year, as we are close to March after this month. So yeah, after that, I then decided to carry on walking. So after walking, I then saw this extra space in the garden. And this part of the garden had some sort of a fiesta-like, well, not fiesta, but a fiesta-like theme because all of the plants were surrounding around this open space, whereas in the middle, there's this old-fashioned or the original clock. So it was on a cement pole, and on top of the cement pole was a base, and on the base was the plate, the metal plate of the clock. So the clock had an arm that was facing 45 degrees somewhere at the north, I guess, and it was staying on the 12 o'clock point, and at the time, as the sun moves around the sky, the shadow would tell the time according to the location of the sunlight at the time. So that's how everybody was able to tell. That was how everybody was able to tell the time at the time. Not like what we used to do today. We use clocks and watches today in this era. So yeah, that was that. And then I went and I saw this house. It looked like a very proper house. It's not a proper house because it doesn't have what we have in the house. But it has a very small space, which looks to be a small room. It had nothing in it. So it looked rather creepy, so I didn't want to take pictures of that one. It spooked me out when I saw the inside. and how echoey it was. I was shouting so loud that people across the garden have heard me. Not across the whole garden, but some part of where I was. Yes, it was very echoey. So it looked like it was a Greek-like because it had poles in front of it, or pillars, rather. Yeah. So that's what it looked like. And yes, that's the talk of the farmhouse and the big tree and that part of the garden. I don't even know the name, but if you do, please do comment in the comments. The next one was the Pagoda Tower. However, I had to walk past the temperate house for that to happen. And yes, it was a very long walk from the farmhouse to the temperate tower, and then from there to the Pagoda Tower. The temperate house was actually in restoration, so I wasn't able to go there. As I walked past it, I then saw the Pagoda Tower, and I really was excited to go there, so I had to walk all the way there. It looked like I was walking about 1 mile. It was very far. So, yeah. And however, before that, I saw a series of trees that don't even have leaves. So, what rather seems to be hibernating trees. Yes, hibernating trees. Although there was this one tree that had barley grass under it. So I had to take pictures of them because not myself, but my family uses barley wood to keep themselves healthy. And I am healthy, obviously, but that was also to keep bacteria out of their body and detoxize your body, and as well as keeping your health genes really good. So, yeah, if you do have these in your backyard, then please do comment in the comment section below. But also, what do you think of taking barley grass as your own sort of dieting drink? Then please feel free to comment down below, and we'll see the discussion from there. So as I finished taking pictures there, here and there, I then decided to walk straight to the Pagoda Tower. And yes, it was a very long walk, so I felt very exhausted by the time I reached there. However, there was this other tree that I saw. It was a very, very tall tree, and it looks like a Christmas tree, but the leaves on it does not look like one. It looks like one of the forest trees, but I don't know, but there you go. It had a triangular shape, although not to the same extent of a real triangle. The branches were touching the ground, but there was this one open space where I can go under. So the branches were covered with its leaves, so it must have finished its hibernation period already, or it may have started it, I don't know. But yes, there were still leaves there, and I was very happy that it had leaves. That was the first one, by the way, of its kind. And as I went under, I saw this other memorial bench, and of course it was for a couple who had been there for nearly 65 years or something. Yes, a very long time. And the name of that tree that I was able to find was the Cedar Vine or something. It says on the nameplate when you see the video, but that's the name of the tree, so it's probably a cedar type of tree, since it's the name. So yes, and then I managed to walk around it and had bits of pictures of it. And then right before me was the Pagoda Tower. So I walked out of the tree and saw the Pagoda Tower. The Pagoda Tower looked so majestic because it was made with bricks, something that you would obviously find, but then it had a red accent to it. So it was brown with red accent. Something that's very rare on a building, because most buildings nowadays are made of glass and stuff like ceramic. So you would pretty much find them in blue, white color, but not in a red and brown sort of livery. So that's what I saw. And I managed to walk around it. I didn't manage to get into it because it was locked up. Not with padlocks, but the door was locked. So I walked around and noticed how very Victorian-like it was. Because the benches were in the walls, and the walls had plenty of space for tall people to rest their backs in. And yeah, it reminded me of
what London used to look like long time ago in the 30s, yeah, 1930s. And yeah, I was able to see history from there. And after that, I was able to take a very good portrait of the Pagoda Tower, although the A380 kept flying past it, which was really annoying but fascinating at the same time, but it wasn't meant to be in the shot. So yes, I have seen a couple of A380s flying past the Pagoda Tower. Not literally close to it, but past it. And yeah, it was a heyday for me. So that's my talk on the Pagoda Tower. That going to the next one was the Japanese Gateway. That was something that I wasn't expecting to see. So as I walked past the temperate house, I wasn't even close to it, but I was on my way to walking past it. I then noticed that there's this cherry blossom tree, but it wasn't a cherry blossom tree. But if you know what it is, then please do comment down in the section below if you have been there yourself. So yes, I passed this tree that looks like a cherry blossom tree, but it isn't. And I almost felt like it was spring, but it's close to spring. But those flowers were already dropping their petals, so yes, the petals were falling off the tree. Not all of them, but some of them. So yeah. And then right in the middle of the Japanese Gateway was this temple. So it obviously indicated to me that it was a Japanese-themed part of Japan. And yes, I have seen plenty of those in Japan when I went to Japan a long time ago. So yes, this one particularly was different. It had nothing to see inside but a wall that was locked up. So it's the same on the other side, nothing but a wall. So as I walked around it, I noticed there were some other trees again. Trees are very common in Kew Gardens, especially in that part of Kew Garden. I noted there were two open spaces which were supposed to be ponds or sort of where water would be, but it isn't. It's the gravel pond or something. I don't know what the name of it, but that's where I saw the gravels. And right in front of me, or before me, and in front of the temple that was a few meters away from me, it says a sign that said, "Please do not step on the gravel. Thank you for your cooperation." Yeah. So it obviously meant that they have spent their time and effort weavering and combing all of the gravel stone. So it's best not to touch it, otherwise you would have to do it all over again. Yeah, I can see how delicate it looks, but also how stressful it must have been to make all of that. Yes, by hand. Or with a tool, without even destroying the rest of the gravel pond. And I saw some bridges that looked like they were supposed to be walking bridges, but they were small. And they were an arc shape, but not a proper arc, but like a proper bridge, but not a, arc bridge. So, yeah. And then right behind me I saw another tree. I don't even know that's the name of the tree, but it looks familiar or similar to the tree before I went to the Pagoda Tower. But smaller. It's the same height, but not umbrella-like as the one that I saw before the Pagoda Tower. And I took pictures again because that's part of my course and my main task whilst I was there. I have taken pictures of plants as well as flowers because we love flowers. And of course life isn't about flowers. No, it isn't. Okay, because flowers is a representation of unity for me, okay? For not somebody else. Unless you would find it that way. So don't take it that way because it's not that related to what your life is, okay? Not even my life. So yeah. So after the Japanese Gateway, I then had to go and walk to the next attraction. I was walking to the Temperate Tower, the Temperate House, sorry, and it was still in restoration, so I then noticed the next attraction, and that is what I'm going to be discussing. Next attraction is the Treetop Walk. Yeah, I mean Treetop Walk, a bridge that is as tall as the tree, or a series of trees, rather. So as I walked past the Temperate House, I noticed that there's the Treetop Walk attraction. I didn't notice that was there.
And of course, I didn't learn the map myself because I had to memorize the direction of where I was going at the time. So at least it's all in the brain. Memory does work, sometimes it doesn't. So it depends on how well you memorize things. So that is the next attraction. As I went there, I saw that there were some people, so I thought it would be best not to take videos, but I had to, because I was already at the attraction. So when I went there, I started to take the video, and then I saw some people staring at me and looking at me, because they thought I was a YouTuber. It looked like I was a YouTuber, because I was talking to the camera and explaining what was at the treetop walk. So as soon as I went to the base, I saw the log that had a display of the xylem and phloem tubes that you may have learned in biology at school, which I gladly have learned, but I didn't know very much. But then I noticed that that's what they look like. So yeah, I finally have seen the mystery of biological tubes in trees, but there you go. Yes, I was able to see the xylem and phloem tubes in a tree. After that, I then went to the staircase. The staircase had a lift on one side of it, but that was not in use at the moment. It may have been broken, or it's in maintenance progress. So that's what it had. And it is spring and winter time, so it is a bit too cold for the mechanics to work, as it may brittle the parts. So we had to walk on one side of the staircase. The staircase was a triangular one, so thankfully I didn't have to feel dizzy, although I fainted a little bit. So yeah, the staircase had signs saying keep to the left. I found it so difficult to keep it to the left because I often walk on the right side of things, and when I walked on the right side there are people in the way, so I had to move to the left and try not to block their way, but at the same time trying to capture some views whilst walking. It was tiring, but I had to take one step, but I'm good at taking two steps, but the stairs were very steep. Yes, very steep. So I had to like carefully walk and film at the same time, because it's not often the thing that I would do, but I did it anyway, just for you guys to see how tricky it is to walk from the bottom to the top of the treetop walk. So as soon as I got onto the top, I felt very exhausted and very tired, because it was a very heavy walk from there to the bottom, from the bottom to the top. So as I got there, I noticed how beautiful the view was. I was able to get a very nice panoramic view, although I didn't take a panorama, which would have been the best opportunity for me to have done so. But anyway, let's get on to the content. So as I went there, I decided to take pictures, of course, and then I went round the treetop walk. It was very noisy because the metal plates weren't even tightened properly onto the border or the frames of the bridge. So I had to walk slowly or walk fast. But I had two teachers in front of me, so I had to walk slowly in order to avoid the noise. But when they were already gone, I was like literally walking so fast, I made a lot of noise. And I made birds fly away from the tree. That was not noisy. However, if you are from the bottom, it wouldn't seem that noisy as it is from the top. So yes, I walked around and I saw some wooden, what seems to be like wooden memorial boards, again, telling some sort of story or something. It probably is, because they were all carved nicely. So that's what I saw. Yeah, that's pretty good, actually. So after that, I then had to go all the way down to the bottom and carry on back to where I was supposed to go, which was the palm house. The next attraction that I saw was the, it sounds rude, but the Sackler Crossing. Yes, I said it. The Sackler Crossing. So that is a lake, basically, with a iron steel bridge, maybe? But it was made of metal, and it vibrated a lot. I mean a lot, when you walk on it. So yes, I saw swans and mallard ducks for the first time, and some other strange stuff. I don't even know what the name was, but they're the ones that have the oriental western look, because they are brightly colored and not so much like yellow, but orange and black and white, orange and black and grayish, as well as white. So that's the color that they had in common. And of course they're ducks. So yeah, that's what I saw. I saw a family of swans, two parents, and one offspring that looks to be a male because of the neck. The neck was quite thick for the swan, so I assumed that it was a male. And because it was an offspring, the swan still had its gray feather from when it was a little duckling, or the ugly duckling. So yeah, that's the swan. I then saw this tree in the middle. Of course, they were still hibernating because they don't have their leaves yet. But I have seen them in Scotland, somewhere, but I don't know the name of the trees. Again, please do tell me in the description below, in the comments below. Yes, in the comment below. So yeah, if you know, then please do that. So yes, I was able to take good pictures of that one, although this is not what everyone would talk about, but it is what it is, a lake with ducks, very few ducks rather, because in the summer you would find plenty of those, but not in the time of the year. So I had very few time to take pictures, and I did. I was able to capture really good pictures with the swans and the mallard, although I wasn't intending to take pictures of the mallard. But they were there in the way of the shot, which I didn't really like, but there you go. So that was the Sacra Crossing. I don't want to sound rude, but that's the name. Then, yeah, that's the lake. So after that, I then went to the route again to back to where I was, and that was the Victoria Gate again. And by the time I arrived at the Victoria Gate, it looked like it was evening because the sun was setting in the corner of where I was filming, and yeah, it was dark already. But it was only 2 o'clock because that's the time that we had to be there, as the journey from there to my college was 1.5 hours. If you live elsewhere, then time will vary, and as well as distance. So that's how long it was, 1.5 hours. And I was literally devastating because I didn't eat anything. I was non-stop walking, taking pictures and videos. So by the time I went to the coach, I had to literally eat everything. So yeah, I took a lot of pictures. And to be specific, I had taken 421. That is not a lot. I often take 1,000 pictures. Yes, 1,000 pictures, but because I was compromised by time and by distance, I had to rush everywhere I went just to take those pictures. I wasn't able to go on the other side of Kew Gardens where the peacocks were. The peacocks, the bird that had the feathers sticking out on the back. And some other houses that I was very curious that I heard of. I wasn't able to see that because of time and how big the garden was. And because of my ability, I'm not that fast. Yes, I know. So, yeah, I had to trample everywhere I went. Almost destroying the forest when I didn't want to, but I had to walk somewhere where I can just cross the borders quickly. So, yeah. Although there was this thing called the Kew Explorer. That is a road train for people to board on, and they can just walk, travel around Kew Gardens taking pictures and learn what's there and what's not there. So, yes. It'd be nice if they did offer segways. Not swegways, but segways. Because with segways, you can balance easily and you can get anywhere quicker than swegways, because you have to learn first and then you can go anywhere. So, yes. Unfortunately, they don't offer that because there's lots of people walking, but why not? It's much more fun to have segways. So, yeah. So anyway, thank you guys for watching, and if you did enjoy this video, then please give it a thumbs up, and if you want to see more content like this, then please subscribe, and enjoy. See you in the next video.